Hello, everyone. It's your favorite host here, Katie Czyr. Welcome back to Katie Stole the Mic, the podcast. How are you guys? I hope you're good. I'm good, just tired. And like, I just had a coffee before because I needed to go to the bathroom. And like, now I'm so tired after drinking a coffee. What the heck? This happens every time I have caffeine, which is why I never really use caffeine to, keep me awake because it just always fails to do so. It sometimes makes me, go potty though, which is good. But in terms of making me bright and alert, no, nothing. Anywho, my dog Buddy is napping on his dog bed next to me right now. And oh my gosh, he's just the cutest little boy. Well, he's not little. He's a massive boy. He's just so stinking cute. My other doggo baby is napping on my bed. What a nugget. My children are the absolute best. There's no arguing it. So to everyone else's children, sorry you're ugly. No, I'm just kidding. Well, not really. Baby and Buddy are just so adorable. I mean, like, honestly, it's impossible to match them, okay? No way anyone in their right mind could tell me that their disgusting, bald, baby human child that's drooling on itself and screaming is cuter than my children. Like, I'm sorry. No. And actually, well, I am kind of sorry. That was a little mean to babies. But, like, actually, no, I'm not sorry because I really can't with babies. They really gross me out. They're disgusting. Anyways, what can I say? Baby and Buddy inherited my great looks. No, just kidding. They're much cuter than I am. Sometimes I just look at them and I'm like, how do I achieve your level of cuteness? And then I realize that it's absolutely impossible and I give up. They're just so cute. Anyways, today is very exciting, everybody, because today I have the second guest on Katie Stole the Mic, the podcast, and I am super excited. This guest has just returned to the States from Ireland, and in between her very busy work schedule, we finally had time to sit down together and record this episode. So let me just give a little background. The guest today is one of my best friends. Her name is Erin. We grew up dancing together at the same studio. And then once we started college, I stayed in dance and Erin to be a little smarty pants. No. This interview is really interesting because Erin has a dance background. So she knows the dance world. She's been in it. But dance isn't ultimately what she chose as a career. She's currently working at one of the biggest accounting firms in New York City. So let me stop blabbing so you can listen to this awesome discussion with Erin. Everyone, please welcome our second guest on the podcast, Erin Calamari. Roll the music. Hello.
Hello. Thank you for having me.
Of course. You're already much more talkative than Eric was when I had him on.
Oh, no.
Yes. The first, I think, 3 minutes he literally gave me one word answers.
It's good.
But then he warmed up. How are you, Erin? How's it going?
I'm doing very well today. How are you?
I'm great. Can you start off by just kind of telling the listeners a little bit about yourself? Like, how old are you? Just give us a little intro,
Sure. Mm-hmm. I'm a 26-year-old Gemini, Sagittarius rising.
Oh, lovely. Love. Starting off so well. Okay.
I'm from Connecticut, still live in Connecticut. Originally from New York, Westchester County.
Nice.
But primarily grew up in Connecticut. I went to college up in Albany, the College of St. Rose. Graduated from college. Started working in public accounting. And now we find ourselves on the cusp of a major career transition.
Love it. Love. If it's okay with you. We were kind of talking about this, everyone, before, we started recording. But if it's okay with you, Erin, we're just going to swing back a little bit to a part of our lives in which
Let's say we are definitely trauma bonded through that experience. But this is how we met, everybody. Mm-hmm. We met when Erin was already at this studio. We'll leave it unnamed. Everyone will remain nameless. Well, actually, in previous episodes, I've named a few people. So when we get to them, I'll tell you their name using air quotes that I've given them. Long story short, Erin was at the studio. I was at a different one. During the summer, at a little summer intensive, I came to the studio where we then grew up dancing. So yeah, that's how me and Erin met. So can we flash back to that? And can you just kind of tell us about your relationship with dance? Like what did dance mean to you? Blah, blah, blah.
So I have terrible memory. So I don't remember how old we were when we first met or what year it was.
I'm trying to remember, and I know I
genuinely can't remember.
I know I was about 13, so you must have been okay. So 12. Middle school, yeah.
Okay, yeah. So yeah. I was 12. Okay. All I remember is that you came, and we were all like, "Who is this person who's so much better than us? Where did she come from?" I'm pretty sure that was the consensus.
Stop it. Oh my god. Oh, and also I remember you guys, so sorry to interject, but literally I just remember I was talking to you and like two other people, and literally you guys were like, "Wow, yeah, like I'm really glad we like talked, because you just like have a resting bitch face. We didn't know if you were gonna be nice." And I was yeah. like, "That is the most accurate thing I've ever heard. Yes, I do look yeah. like I hate everything most of the time."
Yeah, that coupled with my extreme introvertness,
I really didn't make it easy for you.
The start of our friendship.
Yes.
Yeah. For sure.
Love it. Love
but
it.
We got there. You know.
We did. We bonded quickly, I would say.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Back to you.
As far as my relationship with dance, I don't think I ever really thought about it too much. Like, I started dancing when I was 4, and then it was just something that I always did.
Did, yeah.
Like, it never occurred to me, oh, stop doing. Like, I always enjoyed it enough to keep doing it, I guess.
Nice.
I never thought I would be a professional dancer. Never wanted to be a professional dancer. A lot of people, when they're 4, they're like, "I want to be a professional ballerina."
You know, right. Yeah. Yeah.
I never had that thought.
That's
I don't know
usually why.
Why
they like start dance is because they're like, "I want to be a ballerina." Yeah.
Yeah. I was like, I don't know.
It's like, we, not me.
Yeah. So it's something I enjoyed doing. As far as like performing goes, I only liked performing though if like I was. If I felt fully prepared. Mm. Like, I was never someone who could like get up on stage and like do improv well.
Mm-hmm.
That's not mm-hmm. for me. I need to be prepared.
It's so funny you say that, because that's what most of my students say, like when I teach them today, like so many years later, it's still the same, where it's like most people are like, no improv, please no, like please just tell me what to do.
yeah like I don't know.
Did you even like improv? Like when we would do, because we did a lot of improv at our studio. We did. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Merp. I think I tried to like hide as much as possible during any sort of improv, because I think what I lack is like creativity. Like I lack creativity. I'm also like afraid and shy to like I never yeah. want to make a scene or draw attention to myself.
Mm-hmm. So I think that I think you're creative. Yeah. I think it's more of like, yeah, like your introvertedness. Because
yeah,
no, you're definitely an introvert.
yeah. Like whether it was like it would let's like in the context of improv, like whether it was a good, interesting movement or whatever that I did, or like something that was like, oh god, I can't believe she did. Like whether good or bad, I never wanted anyone to notice me and like call it out.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But it's hard to hide in improv. Like, it's much easier to hide in an ensemble when everyone's doing the same thing and everyone knows what they're doing.
Yes, for sure. For sure. Okay, so knowing that you were never like, I want to be a dancer. That's what I want to do. We know that Erin never, that was never what she saw for her future career. When did you kind of decide, and like at what age were you like, oh, I kind of want to lean in this direction. Like, I finally know what I want to do with my life kind of thing.
So I think I never, even still, haven't had like a major career called. I think for a while I was like, oh, maybe I'll just like be a teacher or whatever. Cause like, that's like already familiar to me, whatever. Mm-hmm. And then as I was looking at colleges, I had to think like more realistically, what am I going to do after mm-hmm. I graduate? And I decided against teaching, I think, largely because you don't get paid particularly well.
You don't, nope.
and I realized I was not good, like, managing children. Mm. Like, you know, it would not come naturally to me. So I decided to go into college just generally as, like, I think as a marketing major, but I think I just picked that just so I would, like, be in the business school. And right. then I was like, once I'm in the business school, I'll figure out what I want to do.
Right.
And then in my sophomore year of college, I took, as part of all business majors have to take these intro like accounting classes. So my sophomore year of college, I took an intro accounting class and I just like did really well in it without having to try particularly hard. So love I was it. Like, guess I'll just switch my major to this. There's a very linear career path post graduation. Mm-hmm. I liked that. Fine. So that is how I ended up in public accounting.
That's like, it's also so interesting to me how, like, you really didn't have to try in, like, the...
Don't get me wrong. Yeah. It gets a lot harder after the first year.
I did have to try. Oh, my gosh. I've talked about it on the pod so many times, but, like, I can't do math. I was a good student in the sense that I could write really well. English and grammar mm-hmm. and all that, it came really naturally to me. And then, like, besides from that, talking about science or especially math, oh my gosh, I can't believe, I don't know how that, like, comes so easy to you, quite honestly.
I don't either sometimes.
I feel like people, like, some dance teachers, we've heard this growing up, some dance teachers will just kind of throw this out there and you're like, what are you even talking about? Like, and they always say how, oh, dance teaches you so many things, you'll use it in like every aspect of life, no matter if you go into dance or not. Can you kind of tell us, I have my answer and I'll jump in when the time is right, but can you kind of, do you agree with that? And do you find things that you learned in dance that comes into your career now?
Yeah, I think it all depends on, like, how you frame it, though, and what your relationship to it was. I think for me, there's probably three things. Kind of, like, back to preparation. Mm. I think one of the things it taught me is if you have proper preparation, it'll give you the confidence to do anything well.
Yes.
Because if you're not thinking about how to do it because you know how to do it because you practice it so many times, you kind of free yourself up to not feel anxiety because you know exactly right. what's going to happen.
Right.
Even though you're in front of like a live audience or like you're, even if you're like in a classroom or like whatever.
Yeah, exactly.
You already know what's going to happen. Like you're totally in control. Mm-hmm. If you're properly prepared.
Right.
Well rehearsed.
Yes.
I think it also, for me, it kind of gave me spatial awareness as like almost a sixth sense. I think that's just a good thing to have in general, whether you're like walking through a crowd or like whether I'm in an engagement team meeting, like I can sense when someone's trying to like get something out or like someone's trying to pull back or, you know, whatever. Like I can feel that kind of energy.
Oh my God. Yeah. So true. Like literally I'll be walking with Eric, my boyfriend, and literally he's like walking into a pole or walking into someone. And I'm like, how do you not like just go around it?
Yeah. Cause like in addition to like your own self-awareness, you also kind of learn to anticipate where that person's gonna go.
Yes.
Which direction that person's gonna go. Like you're just kind of like always innately
yes
aware of what's happening around you. Mm-hmm. Which is like agreed. A huge safety thing too.
For sure, for sure. I will say sometimes, you know, I've talked about it on the pod before. I'm very accident prone. It's amazing that I can dance. But do you agree that like, so yes. It gives us all those like really good sensory tools. But also I feel like out of the studio, sometimes we're the clumsiest people ever, everything. Us dancers. Yeah, yeah. And I feel like my explanation is that like sometimes we have to focus so much, and we had to focus so much during our training with all of our sensory stuff. I feel like sometimes it just, we have to turn it off.
Yeah. Like your brain like shuts down.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Fun fact, everybody. this is one of my funnest facts, and I still tell it to this day, is that so, one time I was at Erin's, we were hanging out. And next thing, Erin's making a face. She knows exactly what I'm talking about. And to this day, I still have a scar on my butt from this. And I was at Erin's house. I was like, we were seniors in high school, I think. Or I was a senior, she was a junior. And I'm trying to get down her stairs. We're going to watch HGTV. And literally, next thing, Erin just hears crash, followed by crash, 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 crash. And literally I had fallen down her stairs, hit my butt cheek on every single step. And yeah, there is an indentation in my butt cheek.
I still feel so bad about that. Like every once in a while I'll think about it and I'm like, oh my God. Literally, how did I let this happen?
Erin is just always a part of me now. Yeah. She is imprinted in my butt. Yeah, this is a good old question. We could go on about this for hours probably. But do you think dance was detrimental to you in any way?
So again, I think it's one of those things that depends on how you frame it.
Mm-hmm.
I think for me, looking back on it, ultimately, no. Only because I choose to see everything in the past that's happened that maybe didn't go my way or I thought was a mistake as a lesson learned. Not to say that there are, like, I'm more so aware of it now that it's been so long since I last danced.
Mm-hmm.
I'm now becoming aware of, like, the origination of certain, like, triggers that I have. And these are very, like, I'm not trying to cry the blues. Like, my life's pretty good.
Right, right, right. But just, like still really little. Nothing really bad ever happened to me.
But, like, I'm only, like, now that it's been so long, like, outside of that, like, I'm starting to realize, oh, that probably comes from the first time I was here with this person. I did, like, and a lot of them are, like, dance-related.
Yep.
But, again, I think it's so specific to, like, because I can pinpoint, like, from a certain time on.
Mm.
But, like, those things, that, like, a certain time before, while I was still dancing, like, was fine.
Right.
Like, it depends on, like, so many external factors.
I agree.
But, ultimately, like, dance as a whole, I would say, no, has not been detrimental to me.
No, I think that's a good point, is because, of course, like, with any bad thing that happened, like, you can pull the good from it, usually. And I think that, yeah, especially, like, growing up in dance, it's, you know, we'll get into it, it's a lot. But there are, like, yeah, I mean, that's how we became friends, is, like, through dance, so.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Not to, be more of a negative Nancy, but on this podcast I do like to you know, I talk about dance honestly a lot, and I think it's important to, especially when I'm teaching, I'm not trying to discourage kids from doing dance, but I think it's really important to not just do what our teachers did and hide the negative stuff. So let's flash back to a time in our dance training. I'm sure you know exactly where I'm going with this, to that awful, terrible, tragic time. I think it started when you were a sophomore, I was a junior.
Like, almost exactly a decade ago.
Oh my gosh, you're so right. See, yeah. This is why we need Erin for the math stuff. okay, so we had new directors come in. And we had already, you know, experienced the highs and lows of dance, but this was just a very, very low time for us. Can you, as much as you're comfortable, kind of just, like, walk me through that time and, like, what it was like for you?
I think, looking back on it now, the best way I can describe the relationship between, let's say, us and them.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I have called them. So they're I gave them names. Mr. and Mrs. Potato Head.
Great. These directors were treating us like we were professional dancers who they were paying to be there. But the reality of the situation was we were paying them to learn from them.
Yes.
I think that's the way I can sum it up.
I completely agree. Totally agree. Yeah. Completely.
Like, we, and I think I, sometimes I do have, like, empathy, actually, for the situation that they were in, because I don't think they were given the opportunity of having a transition period, which was what I think was largely detrimental to the relationship between the two. Like, we were both, like, us and them, we were really thrown into this new relationship with no context, no background, no welcome party. And I think both sides could have really benefited from that, because they needed to learn and know more about us in order to better be prepared to teach us. And they were obviously just teaching, like, what they knew, how they knew. But the environment that they came from did not prepare them to teach young children, which is what we were. So.
Yeah. And I, you know, I always say, I think on every single episode, it's not about what you teach necessarily. I mean, it is, but it's more so about how you teach it.
Yes.
And I think that, I mean, I take so much away from that time with what not to do now as I teach the next generation of dancers. Because, I mean, they literally did everything completely how you shouldn't. I mean, I just, not to get too deep into it, but I mean, just the fact that I have visions of us in class, literally, and they're just screaming at us.
Yeah.
After we had literally just literally danced the same piece of Swan Lake 19 times, and they're still yelling at us, and not even anything constructive. They're literally just yelling at us to do it again.
And I think the most concise way to probably sum that up is just a complete lack of support. And support, like, is kind of like a blanket term, but, like, you have, it's, you have to think of who your target audience is, because each audience is going to require a different type and different level of support. And I just, it was a very rushed, I think, decision to have them come in, because they were not properly prepared to offer that kind of support.
Agreed. Okay, so flashing back to a happier time, coming back to today, can you tell us a little bit more about your career? Kind of, maybe, I always think this is so interesting, because any normal job is fascinating to me, since I don't do that. Can you kind of walk us through, like, a normal day for you? Tell us about your life now.
Yes, so I work in public accounting and tax, so I do tax compliance. Essentially, what I do, if you had to boil it all down, is prepare and review tax returns, which, quite frankly, is a 12-month process, pretty much. The clients that I service are all involved in real estate investments. So in January, we start planning for the year. In February, March, and April, we're doing all of the pre-work, or the work papers, which are like Excel workbooks, which tell us what the numbers should be that go on the tax return. And then in the summer months, we spend all that time preparing the actual forms. And then in the fall, we file tax returns. And then in the winter leading up to January, we do estimates for next year's tax returns. So my day to day depends on, like, what season we're in.
Right.
But in the role that I'm in now, if I had to sum it up, I'd say, regardless of the season, what I do every day is review work that associates on my engagement teams have sent to me, whether that be a work paper or a tax return, etc. Mm-hmm. I review that, and then I send it up to review. And then if my manager has any comments, I apply them, and then I send that out to the client. Just heavy communication via all forms of communication that exist. Just a lot of back and forth. Hey, can you do this? Hey, can you do this? Like, oh, you're asking me to do this? Sure, I'll do it. and yeah, that's my day-to-day.
Nice, nice. Very different from mine. Just a fun question. If you could invite anyone, dead or alive, to hang out with us for an afternoon, who would it be?
So, I would say a comedian named Katherine Ryan.
Okay.
Because I think that in this group of three, I think, like, I already know I enjoy her comedy and everything that she does. I'm a big fan of, but I would like to introduce her to you, or like introduce you to her.
Yeah,
you think you would be a big fan as well.
You definitely have shown me her stuff.
She's obviously an outspoken feminist.
Love.
But also, like, not in the way I think that you expect, or like the stereotype of female comedians.
On what advice would you tell your 16-year-old self? Doesn't even have to be deep. Just like, what would you tell baby Erin?
Ugh, honestly, a lot of things, but I'll keep it to like just like two. I would say be more curious and ask more questions.
I pop off on men all the time on this podcast, like every episode. I even made an entire episode called How to Be a Good Boy 101. And I have offered my two cents to the gentlemen listening, if they even listen at this point. What would you tell the men out there in this day and age? I know you're currently single, so...
The thing that comes to mind, like, right now, in the season of life that I'm in, it would be to, like, be conscious of and acknowledge the mental load of womanhood. And as an extension of that, to like jump in and find effective and helpful ways to either like shoulder or ease the burden of that load.
Yes. Love.
On your own, like without having to be told.
Exactly. Very important to throw in, because I know that's an obvious to us, but that's not an obvious to them. Yeah, no, it's, you have to train them to do that. And if they could literally just figure that out on their own, that'd be great. We obviously both went to college. We've talked about, you know, we talked about that in this episode previously. What's your opinion on college? Because I know, especially in this day and age, the opinion I feel like is kind of changing. Do you think, like, should you go to college? What's your opinion on it?
Honestly, I think it depends. Obviously, for the field that I'm in, it requires a master's degree even. It's like, yeah, you have to go to college.
Right.
I think it's unfortunate that there is this stigma, especially for the area we grew up in, where if you're not thinking about going to college, or you don't go to college, then like, you're weird, something must be wrong with you.
Yeah.
You're not
going to
be acceptable. Because it's simply, quite frankly, not true.
Yeah.
And especially this day and age, I think there's something to be said for critically thinking about, is this, like, why am I going to college?
Yeah.
Because I think you should go if, like, you already have a clear vision in your head of, like, I want to be a lawyer, I want to be a teacher. Like, you, regardless of what it is, like, if you already have a very clear vision for, like, what you want to do, what you want to be, then by all means, go. But if you don't, then I would highly consider at least taking like a gap year at the very least, and like figure it out.
Right. Okay, this is a good question. I think I'm excited. I talk about adulting a lot on this podcast. And what do I mean by adulting? I mean that, no, just like we're talking about it for, you know, high school and college, even in college, they don't really truly prepare you for what it's actually like stepping out on your own and becoming an adult. So I've you know, made a whole episode about this. Can you kind of talk to us a little bit about, like, how you've navigated adulthood?
Yeah. So.
So, here's the thing.
I would say, like, things that I, and these are not things that I'm good at. These are things that I'm now realizing are vital as we are in adulthood that I need to work on.
Yes.
But those things, I would say, like, you need to actively make time to see your friends and maintain relationships with them. Yeah, like, I'm, like, realizing now, I'm like, okay, like, there's no excuse. Like, there's no reason why, like, I can't be, like, meeting my friends in person way more than once a year. Like,
I will say, everyone, that Erin, I think it's because your job is, you are just so busy and you communicate all the time, like, all day via so many different, you know, ways of communication. Channels. Yeah. Is that I think, like, you're just so overwhelmed. Erin is literally the hardest person to get in touch with.
I'm like, don't talk to me. I have no brain power.
Like, literally.
The second one is, I feel like a lot of the media and entertainment we consume is just, like, all digital, like, all on our phones, laptops, whatever. So I'm really trying to actively make a conscious effort now to, like, go to live performances. Especially with, like, stand-up comedy, for example. Like, it's totally different when it's in person versus when you're watching it as a Netflix special. Like, it's funnier when you're in person. Like, you feed off of the energy in the crowd, and it's, like, a whole different experience.
Yeah.
So, I'm trying to make more of a conscious effort to do that.
Makes me happy as that you're supporting my career.
And then the third is to, like, read. Like, actual books.
You know me, I love reading, so I don't have to try on that one. But yeah, no, I love that. Love that. And I feel like, I don't know, there's also, tell me if you disagree, but maybe it's just me loving books so much, but I feel like there's something to be said about reading a paper book.
Yeah.
That is not digital, and you are actually holding it, and, like, the new book smell, or the used book smell. And literally, you're actually, like, not on a device reading.
I agree, yeah.
Anyone is listening who's thinking of becoming an accountant, if they're good at being smart like you, what's your advice for them?
So, obviously, gotta go to college. Mm-hmm. Get a degree. But more importantly, I would say do as many internships as you possibly can in different fields. By that, I mean, do a tax internship, do an audit internship, do an internship not at a public accounting firm, and do all of that, like, while you're in college. I would say, like, starting even, like, your sophomore year even, start doing internships and do them all the way up until you graduate. Like, I would say the most common thing to do for accounting majors is to go into public accounting right after college, which, yes, is a great foundation for any type of career you want to do, but it's not the end all be all, and there are plenty of other options and things you can do with an accounting degree. But the only way you're going to be able to, well, the best time to figure that out is while you're still in college.
I know I would totally do this. Would you ever write a book about your life?
No, because I don't think there's anything unique enough that people could, like, learn or take away from my life.
Oh my!
My, like, if anyone, go ahead. I was just gonna say, if anyone, like, forced me to write a book, I'd, like, put it under a different name. Like, I
would. A pen name.
I'd hide so hard.
What would be your pen? I could see you even doing, like, your pen name as a man's name.
Yeah, probably. Yeah, really throw him off track.
I often sound very dramatic on this podcast because I'm like, yes, people do put, you know, nails in your point shoe, like, just to sabotage you to get the sugar plum fairy role instead of you. Like, it is, people like to say that the Black Swan movie was, like, so not accurate, and, like, it was so over-dramatized, dramatized.
Yeah.
Thanks, Erin. Sometimes exactly like that, and, you know, maybe in just a loose sense, but
lesser
still.
Lesser degree.
Yes, a lesser degree, but still, you know, very related. So, anyways, to summarize all, I'm very long-winded, to put that in a short question, do you agree with me that dance is very cutthroat?
Oh, no, I would absolutely agree. It's definitely an environment, I would say, that in a lot of, not every studio, not every place, mm-hmm. like in a lot of places, like, should be more regulated by an outside entity of some sort.
Uh-huh.
Like, there aren't enough protections in place.
Yeah.
And it can definitely, in less of like a physical sense, like it can be very political mm-hmm. as well.
Mm-hmm.
It's definitely a space where, especially as a child, you definitely need to have a parent who's aware and involved enough in your life to always know what's going on so as to protect you.
I totally agree. Luckily, we had those parents, but there are, but no, I completely agree. Yeah, there's something about dance where it's, I feel like it's so, it looks so easy on stage, and like that's what we mm-hmm. train for, is we train to make mm-hmm. it look easy so the audience enjoys it. And I feel like it's that aspect of dance that people are just like, oh, well, it's easy. And when they watch Black Swan or something mm-hmm. like that, and there's all of this on so many layers that are just in dance, it's like, oh, well, that must not be real. But like, actually, that's what it's like. What's the best piece of advice you've ever received?
So, I've definitely received a lot of good advice in my life. However, I really should be writing it all down. Whenever I'm asked this question, I can never think of an answer. But the most recent best piece of advice that I ever heard was, the strong tree is the one that moves in the wind. And I think that's impactful as an analogy, because as a tree, you need to be like firmly planted in your roots and like your values and know who you are. Mm-hmm. But you can't be rigid. Like, you do have to be flexible and adapt and like change to your environment, change to new things that come around, like kind of bend to certain people to like meet them where they are. And it takes a strong person and a secure person to be able to do that.
That's it. That took me a second to think about it. But yeah, no, that's,
you gotta really visualize it.
You can tell Erin's the smart one in this friendship duo, because
Katie you're so intelligent. You do not sell yourself short.
Katie took a second over here to be like, so a tree, and it's gonna, I'm like picturing everything in my mind going through each step. Okay, anyways, no, I love that. That's a good one. If you're a dancer, you're an independent contractor, please help us over here with your expertise. We've talked about this, you know, obviously not on the pod, but 1099s. Help. I do you give us words of wisdom here, because we're struggling.
to keep it short and sweet, so like 1099s, for anyone who doesn't know, is similar to a W-2 in that it lists your income, but unsimilar to a W-2, there's no tax taken out of that income. It's just the gross sum, so it leaves it on the recipient to take out and pay the tax on that income. So, as a blanket general rule,
mm-hmm.
what I would say, it does depend on what tax bracket you're in, but for argument's sake, what I would say is, anytime you get a 1099, take 30% right off the top and put that in a separate bank account called taxes.
That is an excellent point.
Like, I would have a separate bank account just for like a savings account that like you use to pay your taxes at the end of the year. And every time you get paid a check, like take 30% off the top and put it in that account. See, I think in general, my best budgeting advice is there's no limit to how many bank accounts you can have. And you should open a bajillion. I have 4 bank accounts.
I love it.
I have a bank account that my check gets deposited into. I have a second checking account that I use for like unexpected but expected expenses, like how I know there's probably going to be like a car maintenance thing I have to do every year, mm-hmm. whatever, you know, I'm going to have to buy Christmas gifts every year. Mm-hmm. So every month I put money in that account. And then when the time comes, I just pull it from that account because I know it's already there.
Love it.
And then I have two savings accounts. One's for short-term savings goals. One's for long-term savings goals. And one of those savings accounts is a high-yield savings account.
That's for- I have that. I feel smart. Part of that. Yep.
That should be like your emergency fund, like money you don't plan on touching for like a very long time, if ever.
Yes.
So, but like there's literally no limit to the amount of like checking accounts. And also like a lot of times like banks and like stuff will do promotions every once in a while where they're like, I'll give you $500 if you open up a checking account and deposit this much in it within the next 6 months.
Oh yeah.
So like look out for things like that.
Heck yeah. I asked our last guest, Eric, the same question, and now I rephrased it so it fits our relationship. Okay. So I asked Eric, what's it like dating a dancer? And now I'm going to ask you, be ruthfully honest. You know, I always like honesty. What is it like being best friends with a professional dancer?
It is absolutely fabulous.
Oh, well, thank you.
You are so brave, unapologetically true to yourself and your values. You know how to persevere, how to advocate for yourself. You're so intelligent, so articulate, and possibly more importantly, very empathetic and very thoughtful. Hilarious. And you are just the best hype woman a gal could have.
Oh my goodness.
I have no complaints.
Oh my god. You're gonna make me cry. Wow.
No. Okay.
Thank you. Oh my goodness. I should ask people to just tell me how they feel about me more often because Eric almost made me cry and now Hero is making me cry. Okay. Love it. We get to flip the table. You get to ask me a question. Anything. Go for it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So as you know, I recently went on a little European vacation.
Yes.
So my question is, if you, money's no object, if you could travel anywhere in the world right now, what would be your dream destination?
I love that you said money's not an object because that really would have prohibited my answer. Like I said, if you're a dancer, money's tight, everyone. Okay. So two of the people I've been following on Instagram, just because they give me inspiration and stuff, they've been in like the south of Italy, southern part of it, southern Italy. And like I'm technically half Austrian, but like northern Italian. And so, yeah, I don't know. I'm really just kind of loving the whole Italy vibe. And I would definitely bring baby in. Oh, me too. Anyways, so I would definitely bring baby and buddy. I would maybe bring Eric. No. I would bring Eric. I feel like it's like so romantic. And I like am seeing like the little like boat rides and like all that stuff. Oh my God. Yeah. I would definitely go there, I think. Also, I love pasta and wine, so I mean, like...
Great destination. Great choice.
Better than that, yeah. Nothing. No, that was the last question! Okay, thank you so much, Erin. That was awesome. We could talk for hours. We were already talking before we started recording for, like... At least an hour, yeah. Anyways,
thank you so much.
Thank you so much.